Hi, and welcome to the Aspire Europe P3O course. This is one of a set of videos to support our online learning modules and help delegates understand the basic concepts. My name's Rod Sowden. I've been doing the commentary on all the videos, and I look forward to the next few minutes just explaining some ideas to you. As we're talking about portfolio management, why don't we start with the portfolio cycles? Because against each one of these steps, we need to think about the tools and techniques that we might need to use. So in the definition cycle, we have understanding where we are in a portfolio, categorizing, prioritizing, balance and plan. And against each one of those, there's some things we should think about. So when we're thinking about understanding, we've got to think about the capacity of the organization, understanding what's going on with benefits, what projects and programs are going on and how well they're doing. Do we already have P3O hubs set up or do we have commercial contracts to supply services to different parts of the organization that we need to take on board? Then P3O says that we should categorize. Well, in fact, actually, it's MOP that says that. And what we need to know is what's going on with those projects and programs. How do they link to our objectives? What types of projects have we got? So we need to understand if they're IT projects, if they're funded out of operations or capital, construction projects, are they business change projects, process improvement? So we need to come up with a set of categories that helps us to understand those. And then we need to know whether they're approved or not, because it's quite likely there'll be a lot of projects and programs running in those early days that nobody knows about. So it's really important to do that full sweep and then record what's going on. If we've got budgets against them, have they got business cases? Have they got a timetable? And from that, we can draw together an understanding of the whole portfolio. Have we got a lot of IT projects? Have we got a lot of FM projects? Have we got a lot of operational projects? How is that portfolio currently aligned? Because when we come on to balance a little bit later, we may need to do some jiggery-pokery with this. So what we're looking for here is basically simple tracking techniques that categorize projects against those five headings there and any other ones that are relevant. This is a little bit beyond some of the stuff in P3O, by the way. It's kind of, I'm trying to paint a picture for you of what really happens. So then we need to prioritize. So how do we know which of these projects should continue? Because when we're looking at the portfolio, there'll be things that we want to include in it and things that we don't want to include in it. We might find we've got a lot of projects that are lined up to business drivers, but there could be those that are just local hobbies. I remember on one particular pass of doing this, we came across numerous projects that had no resources allocated to them, no funds allocated, but they were still absorbing organizational energy whenever we tried to establish what the risk register was. So are there funds and resources dedicated to them? And what's their return on investment? And when do we think it's going to happen? Because if we've got a cold project, and that happens whether you're running a big program, a portfolio or whatever, we need to have the data to know which ones are important. Those are the kind of things that come up under prioritize, and we need techniques to deal with that. Awaiting techniques, the obvious example, which is covered in P3O. But as you can imagine, it needs a little bit more than that in the real world. And then it's balance. Yeah, what is our portfolio going to contain? So we need to have tools and techniques that tell us about what's the stability of the market that we're in. Yeah, I'm recording this as we come to the end of COVID. Nobody really knows what the market is. So if you were doing setting up a portfolio at the moment, you're going to have to make guesses at where the market's going, which projects, which products should stop and stop. We need to think about the level of change within the organisation. How stable are we at this moment in time? Are there other things going on? Have we become destabilised? Can we cope with the rate of change that's happening? And have we got the ongoing level of investment? Because one of the big issues for portfolio management, which of course is P3O, is managing that, is managing changes in investment as money becomes available or more likely restricted. You need to know which projects to stop. So our tools will be there, our prioritization tools will be there, but we also need to use them to actually help us balance the portfolio. So a lot of it's around information and techniques such as return on investment. And then finally, we go to planning, which is really where our techniques kick in a little bit more. We need to be able to identify and manage dependencies, understand the links between the projects, links between the programs, link between the business performance objectives. We need to then be able to, then we can decide which are the more complicated ones. We need to know what deadlines we've got. Have we got legal obligations we've got to meet or contractual obligations? We need to think about baselining techniques. Where are those projects? How reliable is the information around them? And have we got the internal capability? So things like competency frameworks and other techniques come into their own at this point. And as the market capability there, we need techniques to be able to analyse whether there's enough suppliers to deliver what we need or whether they've got the skills we need for whatever our portfolio is going to do. Okay, so we've covered portfolio definition. Let's have a little look at portfolio delivery and what we need to think about in terms of tools and techniques on that side. Well, for each one of those seven areas that's been identified in portfolio and obviously within P3O, it's more than just techniques that we need to think about. So here's the model that we've pulled from P3M3 that says what needs to be set out. So for each one of those seven areas, which as it turns out are the seven perspectives in P3M3, we need to define standards, responsibilities, processes, which we've already talked about in some of the other models. This is where we've got to think about techniques. So what techniques do we need? So if we look at risk, we could be talking about early warning indicators. We could be talking about different types of modeling, for example, Monte Carlo. When we look at something like stakeholder, we can be looking at analysis tools, tracking tools, mapping tools. When we look at finance, we could be thinking in terms of return on investment, return on capital employed, whole range of tools in that area. Resource management, we're going to think about team performance, individual productivity, that kind of thing. Management controls always is going to be around issues and planning, and benefits is obviously about the disruption and delivery of the change. So we need to think about techniques from that perspective. We should also think that we need to think about competencies and skills to be able to undertake those techniques. Because after this course, you'll know about a technique, but you won't have the competence and skill to use it. And then thinking about the storage systems, which is the tools that go with it. So whether we store the data or we use the system to analyze the data when we're actually in delivery. If I was honest, the current P3O, life has moved on a bit since it was written. And I think we have a lot more examples of techniques being deployed in organisations than were being deployed then, because we've seen organisations maturing and improving. In this slide, I've just given you a quick summary. I think when you look in the course, there are some core ones that you need to be aware of. But you might notice here that some of them apply to all the disciplines. So risk management, we talk about workshops and quarterly reviews, or QRSAs as some people call them, early warning indicators, Monte Carlo as a technique. Some of those work in other areas because you can use workshops in all of them. And those would be used to sort of start a project up or start a program up or even do a spot check. You could even use it to facilitate some internal assurance. We look at planning, critical path analysis, known value are obviously the big ones we associate with planning. But think about contingency planning scenarios. Think about the what if scenarios. Those can apply to planning. But planning applies to everything. So they work for benefits, they work for risk, that kind of stuff. Estimation, lots of techniques associated with them. Estimation, I've mentioned one or two there, 3-point estimations, the big one, but top down, time boxing, bottom up, lots of different ways to go about estimating. The important thing is that you have one of those techniques, because most of the clients that we've looked at in the early days of their maturity don't have anything, and they have a technique called best guess, as far as I can see. Stakeholder, again, stakeholder mapping, impact analysis, that kind of stuff could be used for benefits, could be used for risk, and financial as its whole range of investment considerations itself. But from a project program point of view, we'll be looking at expenditure forecasts, spend profiles, that kind of thing. So there's lots of techniques there. And then we need to think about tools. Okay, well, there's an old saying, a fool with a tool is still a fool. And I don't think that's ever been more truer than working with some PMOs that we've reviewed in the past and tried to help. Because there's been a view that if you can get yourself a tool, all the other problems go away. Well, the problem is, if you get in a tool, you just have another set of problems because the original problems don't go anywhere. So in general, we can categorize them in a couple of ways. There's single process support tools, like there's some big risk management systems out there that really just do risk. Or there's ones that do planning, there's P6, some of those. Then there's more enterprise tools, maybe something like Microsoft Project Online, where you can track a number of dimensions within that so that it's all in one place. Because the problem with a single process tools is the data is spread across systems, so it's more difficult to analyze. And then I'd say the third category you should be considering is information and analysis tools. So business objects or some form of analyzing data, because the key role for the portfolio is to have the ability to do this. So you really want to have one of those. That's essential, really. So there will be some sort of analysis. But remembering the enterprise tools are probably not as good at a single topic as a single process tool, but they do give you a lot of value in other ways, and that they can kind of give you that big picture view on what's going on in the organization. Okay, well, that's the end of the video and the last of the series in P3O. I hope you've found it useful, and we wish you all the best of luck if you're taking the exam.